I'm up. I'm on. Well, good morning, good morning. Glad you're here, and welcome to those of you who are online. And I have a whole bunch of announcements to make you aware of this morning, but just about everything that is most important is right here inside your bulletin. And there's a lot of information in there. There's something that you men are not invited to, so I want to be sure to announce that, because it's for the ladies on June the 24th from 11 to 2 at Deanna Carnley's house. And the address is there. And that's for you ladies. You're going to have a good time. And hope you do. Also, want to make you aware of the card. On the back, there's room for you to write praise, prayer requests, what you're thinking, suggestions. We really do take those very seriously and listen to them, pray over them, take your advice, your counsel seriously, and we're thankful for that. Also, in the back is a monthly calendar. This is what's happening in the month of June, and pretty neat. Everything's right one place. I don't know about you, but I'm going to go home and make sure that that's put up. And then I'm supposed to make this announcement to you. Here's some items that the Tanzania missions team still needs. And so I'm going to make sure I got it right. So I've got it here. They need fine tip permanent markers in a variety of colors, Ziploc bags in 1 quart, 1 and 2 gallon sizes, and they need masking tape. And so if you have those items, would you let Jolene Holmes know or let the church office know? And just we'll make their trip to Tanzania as fruitful as possible. So I was reading an article, and the article was about worship, which we are about to engage in. And worship, the theme of the article was, do you go to worship to connect or to consume? Well, I had to admit that an awful lot of times when I'm sitting in the back there, I'm just a consumer, right? The worship team is all prepared. We expect them to be ready. We get to join in. Worship can easily fall into the category of being a consumer. And the article was saying, are you here to connect? And it challenged me, right? Because all too often when I come, if I do connect, I connect with you, but really the question is, do I connect with God? So I'm asking you this morning, are you here as a consumer? Are you here as a connector? Because you have an opportunity to connect with both people and the Lord our God, and that is a good, good thing. So let's pray, and then we'll just have a brief time of greeting and connecting one with another. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that you place before us. We want to worship you. We want to be more than just consumers. We want to connect with one another and connect with you. And so to do that, we have to do it in spirit and in truth. We want to do it according to your word. We want to do it according to what is right. And so, Father, would you help us? It's all right to be a consumer. We get that. But that's not why we're here. We're here to connect with each other and connect with you. And thank you that worship plays that part, that the word plays that part, that the community plays that part. All of these parts empower us to connect. So we thank you and give you praise, thanksgiving, and with joy, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you take a minute and say hi to somebody?
To the cross, you're calling, you're calling. again victorious. Faithfulness none can deny, through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free, Jesus Christ who lives in me.
Father, we thank you that you are Lord of all. Father, thank you that we can trust you with that, Lord. That when you are Lord of all, that you have everything and you have us. Amen. And Father, we thank you that the power of sin is broken when we belong to you. We are no longer slaves to sin, but we belong to you. And it's your love that covers us. Father, we thank you that your name is so full and that there is power in your name and that your name is worthy of our praise and that you are worthy of our love, worthy of our adoration, and you are worthy of all glory and honor.
Thank you, Lord.
So, Lord, we want to exalt you this morning. As we lift your name high, and that name is Jesus.
Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise.
Father, again, we lift up that name that is above every name, and that name is Jesus. Lord, one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. But Lord, today, we as your body here, we confess that with our mouths, with our hearts, with our minds. You are Lord. Father, we thank you. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for your love for us that is never ending. And God, thank you that we can walk in your love. We love you, we praise you, and we pray this in the precious, holy name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Hi, my name is Darrell Carnley, and I'm one of the pastors here. Thank you. It's good to see your smiling faces. In case you're new, I'm actually one of the pastors here, and I've been gone a couple of weeks. By the way, thanks for praying for us as we went to Alaska and had a baby boy. We have a new son-in-law. He's 195 pounds. He weighed 190. And we're now a family of 10. Four girls, four sons-in-law. 4, 8, 9, 10. That makes 10. So there's 10 of us now in the family. They said I do. And the mosquitoes home. So the mosquitoes stayed away long enough. We were in Fairbanks, Alaska. Actually, North Pole. The wedding was in North Pole, Alaska. And it didn't rain. June afternoon in Alaska did not rain. Mosquitoes stayed away at least long enough for us to have the ceremony. Thanks for those of you who prayed for us. We had some rough spots along the way. I think all weddings do that. We have rough spots. There was some stress. Things maybe didn't come together like we hoped they would at some points. So we kind of circled the wagons. We spent some time praying together, and the message, the word that kind of bubbled up out of our spirit was, Jesus likes to turn water into wine at weddings. And so there's always some unexpected thing that happens at a wedding. If you've ever been a part of a wedding, you know there's so many things that can go wrong. And so we just prayed, Father, as the unexpected happens, we thank you that you turn water into wine, and he did that. And so it was a good week, good time to be away, and we're glad to be back. Happy Father's Day to all of us. I don't know if, Paul, you said that earlier, but thank you, fathers, for all that you do. And as we kind of turn our attention to 1 John, picking back up in the series, while we were in Alaska, we were at an ice cream shop, and I think I sent this. I don't know if you got it. Yes, great, good deal. But I saw this sign in Alaska. It was in the Anchorage area. Since debuting So we're sitting in this ice cream shop eating ice cream, and I see this sign on the wall. Since debuting from a farmer's market chest freezer in 2015, I omitted the name of the place just because. We have handcrafted thousands of small batches of ice cream. Our flavors are a celebration of Alaskan ingredients. We are proud to use products from local growers and vendors, as well as wild foods that thrive in the mountains, forests, and seas around us. We serve extraordinary and adventurous ice cream. Yes, grounded in a love for our community. And then I highlighted this last sentence. Now more than ever, we believe that ice cream has the power to tell stories and spread joy. And so I read that. I turned to another son-in-law who was there, and I said, "So, what story did your two scoops tell you?" And he looked at me like, what are you talking about? And I pointed to the sign on the wall, said, "The owners of this ice cream shop believe that ice cream tells stories. So what did your ice cream tell you?" And he started to make up a story that made absolutely no sense. He was winging it, and that's because his ice cream did not tell him a story. Like my sea salt caramel swirl with baked Alaskan topping didn't tell me a story. It didn't say anything, which in some way means that the sign on the wall was not true. Ice cream doesn't have the power to tell stories. And if it did, how would you know that the story was true? Now, ice cream can spread joy. I'll give you that. I like ice cream. I'm not downing ice cream. In culinary terms, I love ice cream. But ice cream can't talk. But let's suppose ice cream could talk. What story might your banana swirl, your vanilla chocolate chip cookie dough ice cream tell you? What story would it tell you? And then once it finished telling your story, how would you know if the story was true? Well, we really wouldn't know because we have nothing to compare the story with. In a sense, as we dive into this fourth chapter, this new chapter in John, John is encouraging us to think about the stories we hear, especially as it relates to church life and the Christian life and God. And every preacher, every church, every book, every message has a story in this kind of environment, this context, has a story to tell about God. And after you've heard someone tell a story about God, how do you know if it's true? How do you test whether the things you're hearing about God on a daily basis or a weekly basis are in fact true? What do you compare it with? And so we kind of have that before us here in John chapter 4. As we move on in this book, a book in which the author, John, aged John, probably in his late 80s or 90s by now, writing to second and third generation Christians who are being tempted to move away from the things they've heard about Jesus from the apostles and the first witnesses of the apostles. People are leaving the churches, and they're turning back and saying, all that you've heard about Jesus is wrong. There's a new way. There's a new story about Jesus, and it's a much more exciting story than the one these old guys who have died off were telling us. Come, follow us as we leave these churches that we've known and follow a new story about God. And so John writes in part to help his readers understand the difference between this new message about Jesus and the old message that they've heard. And the litmus test in many ways has to do with joy. We saw that in the first chapter. He writes that our joy might be complete. And it's a joy that goes much deeper than ice cream. It's a joy that goes much deeper than any kind of pleasure we might find in the food world. We pick up in chapter 4, verse 1, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming and now is in the world. So we dive into these three verses. There are a couple things I think are important for us to see. The first has to do with questions. Questions. If we're going to test something, if we're going to test a message, then we have to ask questions. And in keeping with that theme, I have a couple of questions today about this passage. What does John mean by spirit? Six times, not once, not twice, not three times, not four or five, but six times he references spirit or spirits. What does John mean by spirit? Is he talking about demons? Is he talking about angels? If he's talking about demons, how do we test demons? If he's talking about angels, how do we test angels? And do we have any biblical precedent to test a spirit in the way that maybe he's talking about? Is John talking about teachers when he means spirit? And if so, what Christian teacher would deny that Jesus came in the flesh? After all, this section is about deception among Christians. Why do we even have to test teachers? Why can't the Christian life be filled with teachers who just tell us the truth and there's no false spirit behind them? Why can't the Christian life be a lot easier than it is at times? What does test mean? And how do you test a spirit? What does John mean by prophet? Is he talking about Old Testament prophets who said things like, "Thus saith the Lord"? But I thought New Testament prophets were different than the New Testament teachers. You had apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. So is a teacher a prophet? Is a prophet of a teacher? Is a spirit a prophet? Is a spirit a teacher? How does a spirit confess that Jesus Christ came in the flesh? What does that even mean? A spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, you can know is from God. Every spirit that does not confess that Jesus, what does that mean? How can an ungodly teacher confess that Jesus didn't come in the flesh? And what if we've lived most of our lives without this testing principle? How often do you test the spirits? Have you been doing that consistently through your life? What if you haven't? Is it possible that you now believe things about Jesus that are not true? Because we have not tested the spirits. And then lastly, what does this even have to do with our lives today? I mean, we've got Mormon crickets invading us. What does testing the spirits have to do with life in Elko County? All important questions. And one of the ways that we unpack scripture and study a passage is by asking questions of that passage, which is in keeping with this theme that John himself presents. Don't believe everything you hear. Test it. Ask questions. We know about asking questions. Most of the tests that we took in school, I would think we probably still take in school today, tests involved asking questions. In math, we may have been asked, what is the square root of 144? In English, we might have been asked, what is a verb? What is a noun? What is an adjective? In history, we may have been asked on a test, who was the first president of the United States? More often than not, testing involves asking questions. This means, in part, that Christians in the local church should be free to ask questions. Even further, the only way to know some truths is to ask questions about the stuff being taught. Some might even say that an untested faith is an untrustworthy faith. Because if what we believe about Jesus, his life, death, resurrection, and its application to our lives can't stand up to a few simple questions, then maybe we need a different faith. I mean, if a few questions knock us off our feet, then either we don't understand the faith or the faith doesn't have us. So one of the first signs that you and I are in an unhealthy church or an unhealthy religious environment is that there's no freedom to ask questions, even express doubts. The inability to ask questions and express doubts is an important part of growing up in Jesus. It's an important part of a healthy faith. Now, this doesn't mean that church leaders will always have the answers. And one of the most awkward and humbling times in the lives of pastors and elders and Sunday school teachers and other church leaders is when someone asks us a question that we don't have an answer to. But church leaders don't have a corner on truth any more than you do. And we don't have all of the answers. We don't understand the Godhead, how God can be three in one. We don't understand this thing called time and eternity. We don't understand why bad things happen to good people. We just know that they do. And there's a lot to unravel there. There are different layers to that. But there are many important questions that your pastors and elders and others don't have answers to. And we kind of need to work through the process of being okay with being uncomfortable in that kind of situation, because we want people to ask questions even when we don't have the answers. Because one of the indications that we're in a healthy church is that we can ask questions. Healthy church has the freedom to ask those kinds of questions. Just because I said so might work in a home with little bitty children who maybe can't understand things because daddy said so, because mommy said so. Why? We have a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old granddaughters, not children, but granddaughters, and they're constantly asking why, and eventually you just, well, because, just because. That might work well with little children, but it will not work in a church with adults. Because I'm the pastor and I said so. Because we're the elders and we said so. Because we've been here longer than you and we know how things go here. Because we said so. So John talks about the importance of testing. Now, before we move on to a second thought, I kind of need to mention a caveat here. One disclaimer, if I can say it that way. When it comes to asking questions of church leaders, sometimes we don't ask questions, we make statements. There is a type of question that's not a question. It's a statement of frustration, of disappointment, of anger, of disapproval. It's kind of like when the young husband comes home from a long day's work. He walks into a house full of disarray, toys everywhere, maybe clothes everywhere, kitchen a mess. He comes home to a young, tired, weary mother who's been doing her best to take care of his toddler, infant, and preschooler. And the young husband has the nerve to ask a question. So what have you been doing all day? Now, if he's wise, he only asks that question once. If he's kind of thick-headed, maybe like me, he might say it a few more times before he understands. You know, that's not a question. That's a statement. Or the young wife who sees her husband's socks and underwear on the floor and says, "Are you really gonna let those stay there?" I mean, she's making a statement. Sometimes that happens in church life. Are we really going to spend this much money on missions? Are we really going to spend this much money on children's ministry? Why are we doing this and not that? there are times when adults, Christians in churches, ask questions, but it's really not a question, it's a statement. It's called passive aggression. We don't like what our leaders are doing. And rather than coming out and having an honest conversation and saying, I don't like the fact that we're spending this much money or we're not spending this much money. I don't like the fact that we're doing this or not doing that. We couch it in a question, which is really not a question. And those kinds of questions, which are not questions, don't foster unity. They don't build cohesion. Imagine the wife's response when her husband comes home and says something like that. What are you talking about? I'm doing my best here. So when John talks about testing the spirits, he's talking about asking questions. But he means asking questions, not making statements of disapproval in the form of a question. It would be better just to say, I don't like how things are going here, elders or whoever. Could we sit down and talk about it? Now we can work with that. We can work with that. The most loving thing we can do is maybe not ask a question, but make a statement. The second thing I see here is that substance to teaching always matters more than style. The second thing I notice from these verses is that when we take the time to consider the teachings of those we're sitting under, and by sitting under, I mean by reading a book, by listening to a podcast, by watching someone or listening to someone on the internet or on the TV, that when we take the time to consider the message this person is teaching, that the most important thing is the substance of what they're teaching and not how eloquent they might be or what they look like or how it comes across. In other words, no matter how educated, gifted, or skilled in communication a person might be, no matter how experienced a teacher might be, the most important thing about the man or the woman teaching is what they have to say, is what comes out of their mouth, not how they're dressed or their accent, how many gray hairs they have, do they even have hair, are they young or old, what does their figure look like? I had a friend in college who was a real clown. No, he was a clown. His name was Tim Schamburger, and he got into clowning as a hobby. And he would transform himself from one person who looked like anything but a clown to someone, when you looked at him, you just wanted to laugh because he was dressed up in the frilly hair, the afro hair with the different colors, and he had a crazy hat on, and the big flappy shoes that clowns sometimes wear, and this huge outfit, and you would look at him and just laugh. But Tim's clowning hobby was a ministry. And after he blew up balloons and made all kinds of things with the balloons, he would then talk about God. And he was very effective. Not just with children, but anyone who was listening to what he was saying. Not just how he was dressed. I think sometimes our expectations go up and down depending upon the package that the teacher is wrapped in sometimes. And we want to make sure that we're gauging teaching not by the appearance and not by the externals, but what is someone actually saying? What's coming out of their mouths? Now, at this point, I'm coming to the conclusion that in this passage, when John refers to spirits and then mentions false teachers, he's talking about teachers. He's talking about teaching, testing teachers. He's not so much referring to demons or angels, though spirits are certainly behind influencing the message that comes out of a man or woman when they're teaching. But he's talking about doctrine. What is it that you're hearing? How does it line up with Scripture? And in this case, what is the most important thing being taught? Now, there's some beautiful expressions and illustrations of this in Scripture. I think of how the religious elite, those who had PhDs behind their names in the first century, looked upon the first disciples. In Acts chapter 4, we read how Peter and John began following Jesus after Pentecost, filled with fresh fillings of Holy Spirit. They're in the temple courtyards preaching and teaching. And it says in verse 13, now when the religious elite, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, did I say uneducated? Uneducated common men, they were astonished. Why were they astonished? Because these men didn't look like they had anything profound to say. But as soon as they started talking, something came out of their mouths that drew the masses. So much so that when they saw this lame man, they spoke to him and he rose up and began leaping and shouting. And so there was a power in their words. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul tells the church, which includes some of the leadership there, for consider your calling, brothers, that not many of you were wise according to the worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. You didn't look like you were much according to the world. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. You're a bunch of clowns. What kind of words, what kind of eternal words could come from the mouths of clowns? You'd be surprised. You'd be surprised when those clowns have a heart for Jesus. And then one of my favorites, 1 Timothy 4, Paul writes to Timothy, let no one despise you for your youth. Just because you look like you don't have anything to say, Timothy, doesn't mean you don't have something to say. You do. But set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. If substance is more important than style, we should not write someone off because they have little experience or training when it comes to teaching and preaching. If God could use Balaam's donkey to communicate a message to the prophet, how much more can he use a mind and tongue designed for human speech? Donkey's tongue, not designed for human speech. Our tongues are designed for human speech. And when that heart of a clown or whoever it might be, it belongs to Jesus, then godly things can come from that mouth. On the other hand, don't automatically assume someone with a degree in the Bible, a PhD in theology, or 50 years of teaching experience is going to bring a word from heaven. Now that's sobering. That's a sobering thought for those of us who maybe have a degree behind our name, who have been in a position of teaching for many, many years, who maybe have been down the road a little bit when it comes to Bible knowledge, that capacity to teach does not equate integrity with teaching. Just because somebody has the ability to teach, has the title, the label, the position, doesn't mean there's integrity when they teach. Thus the need to test the spirits, to test what's coming out of the person's mouth. Does it fall in line with Scripture? Let's break this down a little bit further. Some people get into positions of teaching because no one else would step up and help. They did not, and maybe do not, have the gift of teaching. They have the gift of service or mercy and stepped into teaching role to fulfill a need because no one else would step in. They did. And in that case, it's not that they are purposely trying to draw people away from Jesus. They're just not grounded in the word enough to be in a teaching role, or they don't have the gift of teaching. And in these cases, someone might be accidentally leading people away from the life-giving message of Jesus. Not intentionally leading people astray, but unintentionally. Can you think of a place in Scripture where someone was unintentionally leading another person away? I think of Peter and Jesus is talking about going to the cross. And Peter says, no, Lord, this will never happen to you. What, you die? Never. And what does Jesus say to Peter? Get thee behind me, Satan. So it's very possible for a Christian to be saying things that don't come from heaven. They come from hell. And Peter had good motives. He genuinely was concerned about Jesus. He didn't want Jesus to die, but he didn't understand. And sometimes people get into positions of leadership, of teaching, and they don't really understand some of the nuts and bolts, possibly. And so what comes out of their mouth is unintentionally from the Antichrist. Now, that doesn't mean, you know, we curse them. Oh, you're a bad, bad person. No, we try to develop a culture in which we don't put people in positions of teaching until there's been a faithfulness in a little. And there's been the ability to exercise gifts. And is this person? So we're asking questions. We're testing things. We're still loving. The other way this happens is some people get into positions of leadership and teaching. They have influence because they enjoy power, power over. They love control. Their egos feed off of and thrive through power over others. And they too lead people astray from the life-giving truths of Jesus. But it's not because of ignorance. They're not unintentionally. They're intentionally teaching things to draw attention to themselves. And it's these people that John says to watch out for. Their motives are not pure. They are in it for themselves and not the good of others. They're not saying what they're saying on the basis of what Scripture teaches. They're saying things on the basis of what maybe what feels good. Remember the context. Hey, we've heard a new ice cream story. We've heard a new story about Jesus. It feels so good and others are going this way. Come on, that's not the way. This is the way. Follow us. So there are several ways that this can happen. To summarize, just because people have been teaching a long time doesn't necessarily mean there's integrity in that capacity. And just because someone doesn't look like they would be a teacher or doesn't have the experience, or they're too young to do anything good here, doesn't mean that they should not be teaching. The litmus test for teaching is substance, 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 substance. What's coming out of their mouth? What's coming out of their mouth? Is it bearing fruit? Does it line up with God's word? Which leads to our final point today, that when we test, we have to be thinking about things. And so, point number three, if you're taking notes, the battle is in the mind. The third thing we should consider has to do with our minds. We test teaching by thinking about what we're hearing. The Bible puts a lot of emphasis on our minds. In fact, I heard recently one Bible student say that he believed the Apostle Paul was obsessed with the mind. Obsessed? That's a strong word to use. So I thought about it. He gave some references. You think about it. You think about it. Let me be quick to say that we can't think our way into spiritual transformation. But it is an important first step. And why is it an important first step? Well, because the Bible puts a lot of emphasis on the mind. Obsession or not, Paul says it this way, Romans 12, 1 and 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brethren, after 11 chapters of unpacking the Christian faith, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing or renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. 1 Corinthians 2:16. For who has understood the mind of the Lord as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. 2 Corinthians 10:5, we're destroying arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and we're taking every thought captive to the obedience of Jesus, taking every thought Philippians 2, 5 through 7. Have this mind in yourselves, which was in Christ Jesus, who though was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. Colossians 3. If then you've been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things that are here on earth. Those are just a few references to the mind, to the mind, to the mind, to the mind. And we cannot test the messages that we're hearing unless we think about the messages that we're hearing. Again, we can't think our way into spiritual transformation, but it is an important first step. And not just think about what we're hearing. Here's where the testing part comes in. We take what we're hearing, and then we do what? We compare it to what we believe, what we know to be the truth. Assuming that we've heard the truth, and we know the truth. In math, my math answers were judged by a standard. When I turned in my math work to my teacher, and she was looking at that question, what is the root, square root of 144, she did not just make up an answer. I think today the square root of 144 should be 6 or 13 or 33. No, the square root of 144 is 12. Now, she either knew that because she knew that from previous studies, or she had an answer guide. And she looked at the answer guide. When someone asked me on a civics history test, who was the first president of the United States, and I put Abraham Lincoln, the teacher didn't think, you know, that feels like the right answer. You know, today, I just want Abraham Lincoln to be the first president. So yeah, that's right. No, Abraham Lincoln was not. The truth is, Abraham Lincoln was not the first president. George Washington was. And so when we hear these messages that come to us, we compare them to the truth. Now, John says we need to think about what we're listening to and then compare it with what we know to be the truth. How does this work? Well, I think there are two ways this works. One way that it works is what we're doing right now. You're hearing me teach, and you're comparing everything with what you hear coming out of my mouth with this reservoir of information that you've heard through the years, either about 1 John 4, verses 1 through 3, or some other teaching related to what we're talking about today. So one way we compare truth is when we're in formal structures like this. We sit down, we read a book. We turn on the TV, we watch someone preach. We put on the earphones, we listen to a podcast. We come to a worship service, we hear the preacher preach. We're in a Sunday school class, small group setting, and we listen to someone teach. There's this formal teaching. There's this message coming our way, and we're listening, and we're listening, and we're listening, and you have a decision to make. You're either going to judge what I'm saying on the basis of how you feel about what I'm saying. I feel like that's true. I feel like what Darrell's saying today is true. I feel like what Steve is teaching on Sunday mornings is true. I feel like what Paul is teaching is true. Or you take what we're saying and you go back to what you understand Scripture to teach and how we unpack Scripture. And by this time, you've heard us unpack enough Scripture on Sunday morning to know how we approach Scripture. We start with Scripture. Historical, contextual, grammatical. We have ways of interpreting Scripture. And when we don't understand what someone is saying, we don't necessarily write it off. We go to the prayer closet. We go to the place and say, okay, Lord, I wrote some things down. By the way, writing things down is one of the best ways you can test your teachers. Because if you can't remember what they've said, you can't test what they've said. So when you write it down, the faintest ink is better than the best memory. And when you write down things, you can go back, mull it over in your quiet time, in your prayer time. You know, Darrell said some things last week, last month. Darrell's been saying some things. He keeps repeating this phrase. I don't quite understand it. So, Father, help me to understand this. The other way, which I think is just as important, is in these non-formal settings. You're driving your car to work. You're laying in bed about to go to sleep, or you've just awakened early in the morning. You're out in the garden, gardening. You're watching for those crickets. You know, you're doing different things. You're eating. You're watching TV. And there are messages being preached to us on a constant basis. Maybe not while we're sleeping. But from the moment we wake up to the moment that we go to sleep, we are constantly bombarded with messages about God, about marriage, about the most important things in life. And so I want to ask you, brothers and sisters, as we begin to wrap this up, are you testing those spirits? Are you asking questions about the things that come your way? Now, part of this is a process that you might not be practicing, and that's okay. I mean, we have to start somewhere, and just talking about it is the first step. Let's just go ahead and get it out. Let's just put it out here. Are we thinking about our thoughts? Are you testing the thoughts that come your way? And it's like lifting weights. It starts off, this is hard. I'm thinking about, are you saying be so self-conscious I can't enjoy life? No. But there comes a point when this discipline of thinking about our thoughts is not such hard work. And we begin to know what's from the Antichrist and what's not. Another way to put it is, do you spend most of your time listening to yourself or talking to yourself? My biggest problem is that I spend more time listening to myself than talking to myself. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean, there's this constant conversation taking place in our minds. Messages that we listen to. in my world, it might be, if I could just preach a better message, things would change at Calvary. Or if I could just do this, Deanna might love me more. If I could be a better husband. How am I going to be a father-in-law to four grown men? And now they're going to have children. And I start listening to these doubts. You know, you really can't do that. You're inadequate. You're insufficient. Remember how you've messed up. You've messed up so many times. You have struggled, and you're never, ever going to be. And I listen. I listen to lies. Rather than saying, no, this is where the discipline part comes in. That's not from God, and that's not from God. And there's this process where I have to start talking to myself. That's not what God's word says. And so at different points, depending upon where we are in our struggles with our thought life, we might start talking to ourselves and saying, no, all things work together. Even this bad situation I'm in right now, all things work together for good to those who love God. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. My Father in heaven loves me far more than I realize and understands every pain and heartache I go through. If my Father knows when a sparrow falls to the ground, he knows what I'm going through right now. I am chosen by the Father. I have been redeemed by the precious eternal blood of Jesus Christ. I've been sealed with the Holy Spirit that no weapon formed against me will prosper. I am loved, and nothing can take me out of the hand of my Father. And so I've got to start talking to myself rather than listening to myself. Do you understand where I'm at? Does this connect in any way? I hope it does. That's one of the ways that we test the spirits. We test it in formal ways. What am I being taught? What's coming out of his mouth? But then what's flowing through my mind? Am I listening to myself or am I talking to myself? There are a lot of stories in life. And unlike ice cream, our Bibles really do have a story to tell. And it's a good story. It's a story that brings joy to the soul in a way that pleasures in life can't bring. It's a story about sinners, those who know themselves to be sinners, feeling safe around Jesus. It's a story about those who find themselves who are guilty and yet embraced with love. It's a story that tells us that our felt shame, our soul's distress, is actually what draws Jesus in. See, he finds penitence and distress and need, lack, irresistible. He is the friend of sinners. And if distress and need and lack describe your life today, and Jesus wants to be your friend, he is your friend. He is pursuing you. Let him in. Will you let him in? There is a man who will meet you and me in our distress, and he will show us the truth. It won't be a flip of a coin, true or false. It feels like, no. When we encounter Jesus, we know it. That's Jesus. Father, thank you that you delight in questions. You give us the freedom to ask questions, and there's no question off limits. So, Father, thank you that we have the freedom today to ask questions of our leaders, ask questions of you, to test the very thoughts that go through our minds, to spend more time talking to ourselves rather than listening to ourselves. And Lord, like ice cream, we can come up with some very strange stories that make no sense. At least they're not true. But your word is true. And it's dependable. So we ask, Father, that you would help us believe the truth about you, about us, about our lives together. With heads bowed and eyes closed, what might be swirling through your mind this morning? What are your thoughts telling you? More importantly, what do you need to tell your thoughts? What do you need to tell yourself? While the praise team sings, would you make where you sit a place to think, to receive, to open the vent of your heart and let Jesus love you in ways that he wants to love you.
So on earth.
Close our service today. We're going to go out with gifts. We have Father's Day gifts that the children are coming in through the doors to give out to the fathers. And as they come and pass out gifts, again, we want to say Happy Father's Day. Trust that dads, you'll have a good, restful, peaceful day, whatever your Sabbath looks like today. Also want to remind you that if you need prayer, the elders will be available to pray with you. And we're going to close our service with that. God bless you. Go in peace. Enjoy your day and your week. Amen.
We want our coffee in the lobby.